Good morning. Welcome to Lenten Assembly of God. It's great to see you guys this morning. Paul, Loretta, it's good to see you. Missed you last week. Hope you guys are having a great week. I just wanted to go over a few announcements before we get service officially started with worship. I guess it's officially started now because this is announcements. We have some new information bulletins. They're called What's Happening Now kind of thing. And if you did not get one, the back door or out here on the at the lobby on the information center, you can grab one of those and see what's happening in the next few months. Keep you updated. Ladies are going to women's conference this Saturday, and if you would like to carpool, you can get with Debbie or Alex and let them know, and you can share rides up there. It'd be a good deal. Also this Saturday, if you are available, we are having a work day here at the church. We got a couple different areas we're working on. We're going to be changing some lighting in the back hallways, changing out the LED lights. Hopefully it gives a little better lighting and saves us a little money too. And we will also be have another crew doing some outside landscaping. So if lighting is not your thing, feel free to come on out. You can help with some landscaping, some pulling of weeds and that kind of thing. So if you're able to serve in that way, we will be meeting here at 9 o'clock this Saturday. So if you're hungry before, some of us are going to meet over at 8 o'clock at McDonald's and eat before we come over here and work at 9. So if you want to do that, you're welcome to a little fellowship beforehand. We also have some new welcome cards. If you'd see in the front of your pew, or actually it's in the back of your pew, but it'd be in front of you. Does everybody see it? Welcome card. Welcome card. We would love to connect to you. If this is the first time here, or even if it's not, we're trying to update our records and get contact information in with everybody. If you have a prayer need, you can feel free to turn that in, write that in. You can drop that in an offering bag as it comes by. Brian Ketchum's going to be grabbing an offering bag here in just a second. He didn't know it until just now. But he's going to come up and collect the offering here in a minute. But you can fill those out. If you don't get them dropped in the offering as it comes by here in a moment, you can always put it in the box back here at the double doors, the offering box. And we'd love to be able to take some time and pray over your needs with you. And that's all I have for announcements today. So if the worship team would want to come up and prepare for worship, and just want to take a moment and have Brian come up, I'll pray over offering as he's coming. Just want to take a moment also to welcome those next door that may be viewing or online viewing. It's great to have you guys be able to be with us. I guess Brian's not doing the offering because he's on worship. He's not good at multitasking. If everybody would come up on stage and give Brian the offering. I don't know if we got the better looking option, but Denny, if you'd come up. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for this church. We thank you for the body, the members, Lord Jesus. God, may we not be content with those that are here, Lord, but give us a heart for those that aren't here. May we do as you've commanded and go out into the world, go out into our community, and share your love, share the good news, Lord Jesus. God, I pray that you would take this offering to do just that. Bless and further your kingdom. In your name I pray. Amen.
I often do. But every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a
next one, actually through basically everybody through, except for Maddie. I heard this song probably better part of 6 years ago. It's probably one of the prettiest songs I've ever heard in my life, and it's literally a song a church called Red Rocks wrote it for a woman in their church. She had cancer, and she'd served God her whole life, and she was getting ready to die, and the last thing she wanted to do was she wanted to get baptized, and they thought it was the sweetest thing they ever heard in their life, so they literally wrote a song called How I Love You, but the subtitle is called Linda's Song, and so they wrote it for her, but they only released it on YouTube, and they only made a video, and that's the only place you could ever hear the song, unless you learned it, obviously, but it was, I mean, it paints a beautiful picture of God, and exactly how big his heart is for us, and, you know, it shows just how pure people can be for God whenever their heart seeks after him, if that makes sense.
Everything broken within my
our rescuer. Thank you for lifting our eyes when we can't seem to see you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness. Lord, thank you for everything that you do that we see, and especially the things that we don't see. Thank you for how you work in and around us in every situation, even the ones that seem impossible. We just thank you, Lord, for the amazing Father that you are. No matter where we're at, you are in the midst of it. So thank you. Thank you for that. And Lord, as we continue service today, have your way. Continue to have your way through your scriptures. Just have your way through this place, through our hearts and our minds. For those watching online, have your way in them at home. Because you are with us no matter where we are. So Lord, just have your way today. Let it be you that we hear. Lord, we love you. And we ask this in your mighty name. Amen. That last song, I know it was new, but it's beautiful. Absolutely. Just the way, no matter what we're facing, we serve a God who nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible for him. And it's so wonderful. Now, last week, we celebrated our risen Savior, right? It was a great weekend. We all probably ate a whole lot of food with family and friends. And if you didn't, hey, I just hope you got to eat a whole lot of food while remembering Jesus, right? Okay, sorry, I'm making sure you're all with me a little bit. Seeing a little blank stares this morning. Or pretend, just smile. So, okay, I know, I'm quirky, we know this. Okay, anyways, so last week we celebrated Easter. He's risen. We serve a living God. That's amazing. You know, we talked about why Jesus. And one of the reasons was, you know, that veil had to be torn in the temple so that we could have that personal relationship with him. And that was, it's vital. It was key. And, you know, with that comes forgiveness and freedom from sin and bondage of sin and the horrors of this life. Amazing is that still? I can't even like fully wrap my head around it. I'm glad there's a scripture that says we'll never fully understand the things on this side of heaven. But it's wonderful. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, have just as we speak and read your scripture, it is alive. So allow it, Lord, just help it come alive in us, in our minds and in our hearts, Lord. Just have your way completely in your scriptures today. And in this service, we ask this in your name. Amen. So we're going to start out in 1 Peter today, chapter 1, verses 13 through 25. So if you want to read along, or it'll be up on the screen. As we read this, just open up to what the scripture has to say. Don't just read it to read it. I do it. You know, sometimes we go through the motions when we read scripture. We all do it. You know, you get to doing it and you're reading it. And it's great that you're reading it. But, man, just take a moment and just open up your heart. Invite the Holy Spirit into you personally as we read scripture together. So prepare your minds for action and exercise self-control. Put all your hope in the gracious salvation that will come to you when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world. So you must live as God's obedient children. Don't slip back into your old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. You didn't know any better then. But now, you must be holy in everything you do, just as God who chose you is holy. For the scriptures say, you must be holy because I am holy. And remember that the Heavenly Father to whom you pray has no favorites. He will judge or reward you according to what you do. So you must live in reverent fear of Him during your time here as temporary residents. For you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. God chose Him as your ransom long before the world began. But now, in these last days, He has been revealed for your sake. Through Christ, you have come to trust in God. And you have placed your faith and hope in God because He raised Christ from the dead and gave Him great glory. You were cleansed from your sins when you obeyed the truth. So now you must show sincere love to each other as brothers and sisters. Love each other deeply with all your heart, for you have been born again, but not to a life that will quickly end. Your new life will last forever, because it comes from the eternal living Word of God. As the scriptures say, people are like grass. Their beauty is like a flower in the field. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And that word is the good news that was preached to you. This passage of scripture is beautiful, and it is also challenging. The beautiful is what we celebrated last weekend, Jesus. That's beautiful. Him being our sacrifice. Man, and then rising again? Like, that is beautiful. Being free from sin? Man, that's amazing. Forgiveness? Freedom? Eternity in heaven? Beautiful. Christ laid down His life for us. That's love. That is love. Now, the challenging part of what we read, that is that we're called to live a holy life and to turn away from our old way of life. So, something I want us to notice. So, verse 13 says, so prepare your minds for action and exercise self-control. Put all your hope in the gracious salvation that will come to you when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world. So this, back in the day when it was written, the original recipients of this letter, they would have gotten the image, you know, for put your minds into action. And they would have gotten ready for action. They would have gotten ready for, like, physical workout, physical labor. They would have gotten ready for that. And this is significant because many, many people consider holiness as a passive mindset, as just avoiding the bad things in life we shouldn't do. But now bear with me for a moment. Stay with me. But holiness, it does involve, we have to have that personal restraint and we have to have self-control. We just read it in scripture. But it also means being set apart from ungodliness and having an active pursuit of freedom to fulfill God's plan for our life. That's the key. That's the part of holiness that we see in Scripture that gets left out. Holiness includes that active pursuit for us, calls us into action to pursue the things of God and to pursue the plan that He has put on our lives. It's not just a mindset. We can't just say, oh, holiness is a mindset. I'm trying to be more like Jesus. I say that all the time. But the side that we don't say that we have to do is the side that we got to be active in pursuing the goodness of God and being more like him. Because when we ask Jesus into our lives as our Lord and Savior, that's where we get our hope from. You know, us knowing that no matter what we face today or what tomorrow brings, we know that our hope is in Jesus. And we know that he is who he says he is. He said that he was going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, and he did just that. He is who he says he is. And we can trust that. Because when we do, there's a freedom. There's healing. Not just physical healing. Yes, that's amazing. But an emotional, spiritual healing also. Because this life isn't without wounds. It's not. And there's a glorious future with him. Eternity. It's not just for us, but for all of us. Eternity is available to everyone who calls on Jesus as their Lord and Savior and has that personal relationship. And that's beautiful. But we can't be so focused on eternity that we're no good here on earth. That's dangerous. When we're so focused on what's to come that we don't stop to live or try to grow and be more like Jesus here, that is dangerous. What's that phrase? You're so heavenly minded, you're no earthly good. We can't be that. Jesus never said that we need to be so heavenly minded we were no earthly good. He didn't say that anywhere in any translation. So we shouldn't do it. Point blank. So, verse 14. So you must live as God's obedient children. Don't slip back into your old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. You didn't know any better then. When we accept Jesus, we're reborn. That's what it's called. Rebirth, reborn. We're saved. We step into a personal relationship with him. It's got 100 different names. But what that is when we accept him, we have a new life. The old us, there's forgiveness there. From the mistakes we've made, from the choices that were less than holy, we're forgiven. And we get to start fresh, new. And then into that, we carry forgiveness. So then when we do mess up, we go to our Father and we say, Lord, forgive me. And then we earnestly try to do better. And then we also have this cool thing called accountability when we're born again. I say it's cool. It kind of is sometimes. It's really awesome if you're not doing anything wrong. It's great. But when you start to step out of line and you've got those people in your life, they're like, hey, what are you doing? Take a step back. You're like, okay. Later on, you appreciate it, but in the moment, it does not feel good. But being part of the family of God, we have that. We have each other. We're not at this alone. All right. 1 Peter 5:8. Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. This right here is a warning. We are called to live holy. We see throughout Scripture several times, hey, look out for the devil. He's trying to take you out. Hey, he's a roaring lion. Hey, he came to steal, kill, and destroy. That's his purpose. That is what he wants to do. So we have to take these alerts. We got to take these warnings seriously. Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. See, the enemy has lost already. Jesus has already won. It is in Scripture. We've talked about it a lot. We'll never stop talking about it. He's already won. That's amazing. The enemy has lost. But he wants to take us down with him. The enemy wants to take us out. For a moment, we're going to talk about something. Ready? It's not controversial, I promise. Okay. So, it's something we all know. Everyone. I know, I'm building up suspense. That's it. All right, so, God and the devil are not equals. They're not equals. The enemy is not the bad equivalent of God. The enemy was created. He was an angel. He did his thing. He disobeyed. You can read about it in Scripture. Go find it this week. And then he was sent to earth. He was punished. He left. He's not equivalent to God. They're not equals at all. We so often talk about the enemy as if he's equal to God. And I'm guilty of this myself. We say, oh man, the enemy is at it. He's doing this and this, and he causes this and that. But you know what? He's not equivalent to God. He has no power over God. God can stop him. He already has with Jesus. It is up to us. It's up to me, and it's up to you as individuals to use our free will to choose who we serve. Are we going to serve Jesus, or are we going to serve the enemy? Because those are our only two options. Who are we allowing to be Lord of our lives? And not just the life that other people see, but the life that only God sees. I've heard it said many a times, don't let the enemy have a secret on you. Who's the Lord of your private life when no one's around? When it's just you? Who are you serving in those moments? Because that's who you're going to serve when push comes to shove and the world falls down around us. If we give the enemy power, he's going to run with it. If we cut the enemy off at his knees by choosing Jesus and following Scripture, he has no power over us. Ugh, you guys, even when he tries. 1 Corinthians 10:13, the temptations in your life are no different from what others experience. And God is faithful. He will not allow the temptation to be more than you can stand. When you are tempted, he will show you a way out so that you can endure. Now, notice this. He will not allow the temptation to be more than you can stand. Might mess with some of your theology. He gives us more than we can handle. That's nowhere in Scripture. He does. You know, we've seen it. We hear it said, God will never give me more than I can handle. No, he will. Because that's not in Scripture. He will never give us more than he can handle. So that we turn to him, to give him the things, to count on him again, to put him back as Lord of our life. So there are things in our lives that come, and it's way more than we can ever handle on our own. But it's so that we turn back to our Lord and Savior, to our Heavenly Father, to put him back on the throne of our lives. We gotta realize that. Now, this is talking about temptation. He will never allow us to be tempted more than we can handle, more than we can endure. And he will always show us a way out. So, with that, if we are following Jesus and we allow the Holy Spirit into our lives, we have to have the Spirit. We have to invite him into our life. We have to, in those moments of temptation, it is up to us to say, Jesus, help me, and then get out. Walk away. Set up blockers. Whatever it takes. Because the enemy, he does not care about us at all. We have to use what we are taught by Jesus. This is one reason it is so vital for us to be in Scripture. Now, how can we know what's of God and what's of the enemy if we haven't picked up a Bible? How can we know the difference? Or if we haven't picked up a Bible and read recently, because it's in me, I read it as a kid, I don't need to stay refreshed in it. That is bull, okay? I said it, it's bull. If you grew, I don't care if you grew up in church, you didn't grow up in church. If you say, I read it once, that's good enough for me, then clearly you didn't read it close enough. Because the enemy knows Scripture too. And when we're in a situation and he's trying to take us out slowly by slowly, and he's whispering twisted scriptures in our ear, and we confirm that because we're like, okay, yeah, I remember reading that. I got Scripture in me. No, we're going to follow him, and the next thing you know, who knows where we're going to end up, because we're following the enemy instead of Jesus, because we won't pick up a Bible and read it. That's not okay. We got to be fresh in Scripture. Yes, is this strong? Yes. Does God love every one of us so much that he put this on my heart? Again, yes. Love is hearing the truth. Man, the enemy, he hates us. To hate in Scripture is to commit murder in your heart. Enemy, he doesn't care. What he wants is people to go down with him. That's what he wants. And we might as well say yes to him if we're not reading our Bibles. We might as well. Because if we're not reading Scripture and following Jesus, what are we doing? Who are we serving? As we read in that first passage, 1 Peter verses 15 through 16, but now you must be holy in everything you do, just as God who chose you is holy. For the scriptures say, you must be holy because I am holy. We are called to live a holy life. It is possible with the Holy Spirit. Remember how we said the enemy and God are not equals? The Holy Spirit was sent as a helper from God. Jesus, he told us this before he ascended. The Holy Spirit was sent as a helper, our advocate. He is part, the Holy Spirit is part of the Trinity. The Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit, depends what translation. So, when we're struggling, we have, when we've accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we have the Holy Spirit, which is stronger and has power over the enemy. See where I'm going with this? This is good. This is very good. So, we have the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit has power over the enemy. Which means when we face temptation, when we face the pulling of going back to our old ways, we can say no and stand firm. Because we have God's word in us and we have the Holy Spirit with us. Oh, as we remain fresh in Scripture, we then know what is of God and what is of the enemy. This has got it. Does this give you hope? I mean, if this doesn't give you hope, we need to talk. Okay? Because we got the Holy Spirit, you guys, who has power over the enemy who wants to take us all out. Come on, this is good. This is worth celebrating. So no matter how much we're tempted, no matter how much the enemy's like, come on, come back to the bottle, Debbie. When I really crave alcohol, and I still do to this day, 9 years sober, when I really crave it is when I am going through a lot spiritually. And the enemy's like, come on. He whispers. And I say, no. I say, I do not serve you. I serve Jesus Christ, get away from me. Because I know when I have a craving to go back to the old way, it's because God is doing things. And the enemy sees it. And he wants to take me out. So then it takes out my family. And then it hurts a bunch of people around me. But you know what? I serve Jesus Christ. And I choose him every time. And I will choose him every time. Because, oh, I love you guys. Okay? I'm just saying. And I love Jesus. And I want everyone to be saved. Is that a lofty goal? No, it's not. Because we serve Jesus Christ. It's possible. I don't care. It's possible. So, with all that, we can do this. We can be holy people. We can. Holiness is not just it's not a passive mindset. It requires positive action and pursuit of freedom to fulfill God's plan for our life. Then, when we mess up, holy people admit it, and they go to Jesus for forgiveness. And if it involves someone else, you apologize. And then you move on together. And you strive and you grow together. Because, man, forgiveness. You get freedom from gossip, anger, control. Yes, control is poison. Okay? Control in our personal lives. Control at work. When we want to control every single minute detail because we want it to go our way and we think we know what's best, that is dangerous because then we stop listening to God. We have to be willing to let up control, us, our humanly control, so that we can allow God to come in and let him control. When we put him first and we answer to him, we don't have to control every minute detail of everything in our lives. This is a dark spot for me. When I get real nervous and anxious about stuff, I'm being real honest right now. I keep an eye on it because my instinct is I want to control everything, down to how my floor is swept at home. Okay? It's ridiculous. I'm talking about me here. So, when I start feeling this way, and I know it because it's a bad spot for me, I go to Jesus. And sometimes it's while I'm cleaning the house and praying, and I'm like, okay, God, I'm trying to control every single thing. I'm turning this back over to you. I'm sorry that I tried to take control of all of it again. Please come in. And it's awkward sharing that story with you, but we gotta do it. We gotta keep an eye on the spots in our life so we can go to Jesus and we can grow. We can grow. Now for every one of us, our struggle is different. We all have something. The temptation in all of our lives is different for every one of us. Some of us might have similarities. But the enemy, he has had many years of perfecting his game. Many years. But Jesus already knew. That's why we have scripture. To fight against it. So some days the struggle is real. It is real. It is hard. But that's why we have Jesus. That's why we have the Holy Spirit. And that's why we have each other. We're the body. We're family. Yeah, we might not get along all the time, but we have to come back to each other. To pray. To talk to one another. To say, man, I'm struggling with this so hard. I just need a listening ear. We listen. We pray for one another. We don't gossip about it. And we move on. Right? That's why we have each other. This life is not hopeless. It's not. There may be situations that seem hopeless, but there's always hope in it when we allow Jesus in. This life is not hopeless with Jesus Christ, and we can be a holy people. Romans 12:2. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. We're going to read that again. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. When we invite Jesus in and invite the Holy Spirit to have his way, he transforms our thinking every time. Sometimes it's a little at a time. It is. Sometimes it's all at once. But we have to invite him in and ask him, hey, help me here. I need this. And then be open to listening to him when he corrects us. Because he's faithful to stay true to his word. And if he says, if we ask, he's going to do it. Last week we celebrated Jesus. This week we take responsibility for our relationship with him and honor and live in honor to what he did. We are called to be holy people, not follow or copy the ways of this world, but to be more and more like Jesus every day with the help of the Holy Spirit. We have this. We have this because we have the Holy Spirit and we have each other. Come on, that's good. If I was going at this alone, that'd be so depressing. That'd be awful. I couldn't just like call Mick with randomness or GJ or Cameron when I send her random text messages. I mean, or ain't all of you. I'm grateful. I love you guys, and I thank God for you. I do. Because he knows what he's doing. He knows why each of us are here together. So, where are you at with this holiness? All right, here's a question. Don't answer it out loud. So, the people that you were closest to, for a minute, picture the people that you're closest to. Is it your kids, your spouse? Is it the people you work with, your family? The people you're closest to. Would they call you holy or would they call you a hypocrite? And be honest with ourselves, because we all can lean on the hypocrite side sometimes, where we act one way at home. We're out in the public or at church and we act a totally different way. So what would they say? What would the people that live in your house say? Would they say that you lean on the holy side or the hypocrite side? I don't ask that to beat anyone up. I ask that because we all have to be real with ourselves. Are we ready to stay fresh in Scripture, to do whatever it takes? To be intentional with our walk with Jesus? To ask for help from the Holy Spirit? To ask for forgiveness? To live a holy life? Are we ready for that? Because clearly God is ready for us to do this. I mean, I'm ready. When you say yes, do you get like that little feeling of sheer nervousness in your stomach? Yeah. Just me? I know I'm not the only one. So when I say yes to God, he's like, all of a sudden the nerves kick in. You're like, I know what I heard. I'm sticking with that, even though I'm shaking in my sandals. This is one of those times that's going to happen, and it's okay. Because once we know Jesus, then we're called to be holy. We're called to strive after that. We're called to more than what the world offers. And after we say yes, if we get a little nervous, that's good. That is good. I have been told several times that when you stop getting nervous, you have a problem and you go reevaluate yourself. So, you know, take that nervousness, let it empower you to live holy if you say yes. So, that's my next question. Who? All right, everybody close your eyes. First, if you're here, I and you don't know Jesus is your Lord and Savior. And this was a lot of, I didn't quite realize that. I didn't realize that, you know, there's this hope in Jesus and this freedom from things that I struggle. If that's you and you'd like to know Jesus and you'd like to start that relationship, you know, maybe the home you grew up in is rough. There was a lot going on. And you felt like you were alone. You're never alone. Jesus is there. He is there with you all the time. When you're crying, when you're upset, when you don't understand why the parents keep fighting. Man, he is there. And he's pulling for you. He's saying, come on, you can make it. You can do this. Excuse me. But man, or maybe that's how you grew up and you're not in it right now. You grew up and it wasn't always the best of times. But you know what? There's forgiveness and freedom now. And if you are in it right now, there is a freedom and a hope knowing that God can move mountains. That Jesus can change any situation. So if you're here and you would like to rededicate or ask Jesus into your life for the first time, I would love to pray with you. Or if you're watching online, would you just slip up your hand? I would just love to pray with you. Thank you. Thank you. Just repeat after me. Lord, I come to you right now and invite you in as my Lord and Savior. Forgive me for my sins, but take my life from here. Let it be yours. Ask this in your name. Amen. Now, if you're here and you know Jesus, I know, don't fall asleep. Your eyes are closed for a minute. Don't go asleep. Stay awake. I would say you could punch your neighbor, but don't do that. Violence is bad. All right, so if you're here and you know Jesus, but you want to strive and to live that holy life, you want to put into action the pursuit of freedom to fulfill God's plan for you. You're ready to say yes. Okay, I've said yes to you, Lord. I'm following you, but now I'm ready to put this holy life on. I'm ready to strive after this. I'm ready to just come after you in that pursuit for what you have for me. And part of that is to tell people around me about you. Because it's not just about us, it's bigger than us, it's about the kingdom. And if you're ready to live that holy life so that the kingdom can advance, would you raise your hand? If that's you, if you're ready to be a part of the kingdom advancing by doing our part and saying yes to living a holy life with one another and turning away from the old life, would you raise your hand? Everyone's eyes are closed. There's no shame. Only I can see. Thank you. Thank you. You can open your eyes. So look to your left and your right. Amy, I'll be on your right, since you don't have anyone. All right, do you look to your left and your right? Do you know the person to your left and your right? If not, you should know them right now. Can't be, that's cheating. All right, so you look to your left and your right. Your goal this week don't have their phone number, share it with one another. Don't spam each other. But, and if you don't have anyone to your left and right, text me so I can text you. Okay? So, this week, the person to your left and your right, I want you to text them. Just a simple reminder. Hey, you got this. The Holy Spirit's with you. Or, hey, nothing's too hard. Simple things that are truth based out of Scripture. Because life gets hard, and throughout the week we need one another. So our exercise this week is to do just that. Now, if you're sitting, I don't know, that's too easy. I'm changing my mind. We're still going to do that, but we're going to switch it up. Someone that you don't text on a regular basis throughout the week. There we go. Okay. I hate that we're live streaming this right now. I'm just saying. I do. Because I have what I written down, but I'm looking at you and I'm like, no, I don't like that. Okay. So, if you're on live stream, have a fantastic week. Text someone encouragement that you love them, that they're doing it. Write it on here. If you don't have anyone to text, type your name. I'll message you. We love you. Have a wonderful week. Goodbye, live stream. Okay. I know now you're all a little nervous, aren't you? Debbie cut the live stream. That's not good. Okay, so.